You are looking at fully modular personal storage with built-in factory, composed entirely from blueprints. And one of those blueprint 4x4 stacks is taking care of endgame items like fused modular frames, turbo motors, heatsinks, and cooling systems. Add to that production and storage of fabric, gas and iodine filters, alongside with automation of automated miners, and you can have everything for endgame Satisfactory with tools for Mark III miners, drones, and radiation protection. Previously, in first two videos on my modular storage, I have covered four modules. Those include one module for bio-waste processing, one module for steel and iron items, one for electronics and locomotion, and finally, one for advanced electronics like radio control units and supercomputers. And today, we are getting close to the full package. There is still one extra module to cover every weapon type in Satisfactory, but this is a story for the next video. Today, I would explain schematics and logic behind the endgame module. I would explain how it is tied to previous modules, and of course, I would explore extra features and functionality. This is the set of those items that, frankly, I have never automated in my Satisfactory gameplay. Usually, I just borrow items from endgame space elevator factories for my personal use, but with modular storage, I have the tools and reason to finally automate this small batch of endgame items for the personal use. Surprisingly, this small factory not as small as it looks, and it still rely on some of previous modules. As usual, all blueprints are available for free in the pinned comment down below. Click-clack those YouTube buttons, and maybe this channel will lift from obscurity and I would stop thinking about cutting content creation altogether. So, without further ado, let's check out the schematic. Alright, so this is the full schematic for the full module. The ratios in the game would be a bit different, but for the most part this is the whole idea. There are a lot of imports and there are a lot of like finished product imports, for example heavy modular frames, radio control units and motors. Why is that? Well, first of all, producing all of those things in this particular module, there is just not enough space. For example, things like automated miners, cooling systems to such a huge extent, for example like gas filters, iodine filters, if I would be producing like heavy modular frames or radio control units on the side, those things would probably not happen over here. Even if I would be producing one of those, I will still require to make all this extra logic with the smart splitters, like protection bin, splitting things evenly, etc, etc. There are a lot of things going on even for one item, and if I'm doing one item, well, I just better off doing several items, you know? And this is the reason why I actually increased production ratios of heavy modular frames and radio control units in previous modules. I was already thinking about this particular module, so I actually wanted to have an extra kick out of those modules. Now let's talk about alternative recipes. And first one on the list is heat exchanger. This is more of quality of life recipe, this is not really like deal breaker, but in reality we're actually importing the rubber into the blueprint. Well, why not to use that particular recipe to actually avoid inputting copper and doing more belt work and actually saving a bit of space. So this one is more of like quality of life. Next alternative recipe is not an actual alternative recipe, and this is like bizarre case of the polyester fabric. This is the only way to automate fabric without constantly inputting finite resources like biomass. And well, yes, I'm importing polymer resin, I'm not doing some weird things with the oil over here, and the sole reason for that is, well, in the next blueprint, in the next module, I will be producing weapons and I will be having heavy oil residue production, and this would have the byproduct of polymer resin, so this is the option to actually sink that over here and produce and semi-automate the fabric. Another option that I will be using in this module is just inputting fabric straight. This is due to reality that I have bio-waste processing module that is already producing fabric, so this is like semi-automation of several things at the same time, all converging on the gas filter production. Another bizarre recipe is automated miner. This is the weird one because, well, before that, the only other option is the crafting bench. In the case of the fabric, you kinda can semi-automate that stuff before, well, polyester fabric, but in the case of portable miner, this is the only option, so this is not really like an alternative recipe, this is the only recipe you can actually use. And the bizarre thing is the drones. So upgrading miners is kinda alright, you can handcraft those things, this is not an issue, but when you are making like drone army, well, you will need to have those portable miners automated. This is like really a nice quality of life feature for the end game. And as usual, we are using a bunch of standard recipes that are not really like alternative recipes, they are basically upgrade recipes. Things like steel rods, solid steel ingots, they save you energy, space, and well, the resources itself. There is only one option there, just use them, and that's it. Alright, so this is level 1, modular storage, this particular module. Yes, very nice English over here. But, most important, over here we have a bunch of crafting stations and very important jokes. After that we have our industrial storage containers for the all the items. And we have our processor and protection bin, which are basically another set of industrial storage container. So the good question is, how does this thing function? So after you put items into the processor, into the storage container, they will go onto the sushi belt. This sushi belt have a bunch of smart splitters. Every single smart splitter separate things to well-dedicated production chains. For example, motors will go to the places where a motor is required, fabric will go into the places where, well, the fabric is required. If there is some item that doesn't belong to the production chain of any sort over here, it will basically end up in the protection bin, because every single smart splitter have the overflow setting. But there is another challenge. For example, you input something more than one stack of motors. Well, the machinery can only hold up one stack of the motors. So every extra motor after that will basically overflow in the smart splitter and will end up in the protection bin. And there are only two ways to avoid that. First of all, you can just avoid overflow setting on the smart splitters and go for any non-defined. This way you can still protect your system from the non-native items and they will go into, well, protection bin, but then we have an issue of clogging up. So if you input several stacks of motors, your machinery will clog up the system, the sushi belt. Everything behind this particular splitter with the motors will be not available until, well, the machinery will go through all the motors. This is not great design, also for the personal storage is definitely not a great design. So another option to have buffers. After every single smart splitter, you will have industrial storage container worth of buffer. So for the motors, I have the industrial storage container. The same goes for radio control units, heavy module frames, fabric, polymer resin, blah 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 blah. So you get the point. So far it was very simple and, well, now we are going into more advanced territory. So, the gas filters. We have only one industrial storage container to hold the gas filters or iodine filters. How this thing actually works? Well, we have the power switch. This switch is basically a direct power chain to manufacturer that is producing iodine filters. When it is off, well, you are not producing iodine filters. When it is on, majority of gas filters will go into iodine filter production and they will be converted into iodine filters, and those will be merged over here into this container. But I want to have another option. I want to have an option of taking all the gas filters that I produced before and to convert them into iodine filters. So I take the gas filters from here and just put them into processor. How it will be handled internally. And first we need to understand the fabric, because it is closely tied to the gas filters. So here's the level number 2, here's the refinery for the polymer resin. It obviously converts fabric, and if this fabric will overflow, it will go into the storage container from this smart splitter that is, well, just after the outtake of the refinery over here. And we have another option to just input the fabric straight into the processor. Over here we have the smart splitter and it splits polymer resin and fabric. In both cases the fabric will end up over here in this industrial storage container, in this buffer. After industrial storage container, after the fabric buffer, everything goes into this manufacturer, which is, well, gas filter manufacturer. Very simple, very straightforward. But what actually happens after the gas filter production? So there is two options how you are producing iodine filters. First option, to just input the gas filters directly into the system through the processor and convert them into iodine filters. Another option, to just enable your iodine production in the form of your manufacturer and to convert everything that is producing before that, the gas filters, into iodine filters. But there is an issue with that system. So if you have only one intake for your iodine filter production, then you need to have the buffer, because, well, we can input the whole industrial storage container of gas filters. If this actually shares the line with actual gas filter production, well, we have an issue in form of the gas filters. So if we have the buffer before iodine filter production, then when you are making the storage for the gas filters itself and do not really want the iodine filters, well, you need to fill up the whole industrial storage container versus of gas filters. And this is not a great design, so we need to avoid that. So over here we have the smart splitter for the gas filters when they are being input into the processor. Over here we have the buffer, pretty straightforward. But over here we have another smart splitter that is also splitting the gas filters, but this is different belt. This is not the sushi belt. This is the belt that is being connected to the manufacturer number 1, to actual gas filter production. And over here we have split to our manufacturer with iodine filters. Very simple. But this split does not have buffer. So if you want to just produce gas filters, there is only one conveyor lift worth of buffer before the manufacturer producing iodine filters. And in this fashion, when this thing is turned off, well, you do not need to fill up the whole industrial storage container of gas filters, and all gas filters produced over here, they will go into your actual personal storage. An actual trick over here that we, well, only using 3 intakes to produce iodine filters, but because we have sort of like 2 ways of inputting gas filters, I am using all 4 intakes in this manufacturer to produce the actual thing. So over here we are inputting gas filters from the buffer, and over here we are inputting gas filters from the actual production of gas filters. So there's a trick. After that, there is not a lot of things that is advanced. Actually, there is none. I pretty much explained everything else. So basically you take your like heavy modular frames, put them into processor, they go into buffer and go into production chain and being converted in fused modular frames. Same goes for all the items on this legend. Very simple and straightforward. Alright, machinery. So first of all, blenders. Blenders are a bit annoying. You could not really stack them like you can stack manufacturers. They are kind of hard to work with. So over here we have our fused modular frame conversion. I'm overclocking this thing. I'm not really pleasant with that because, well, let's face it, blenders are kind of the most power hungry machine in the game. So over there I will be using actually 2 blenders for production of the cooling systems. I will not be overclocking them to 250% because it is like a lot of power. On the level number 1, we have our buffer for the heavy modular frames. Then we have over here 4 constructors for the aluminum casings, and after that on the second level we pretty much have everything about the steel. We have production of our iron ingots, steel pipes, iron plates over here, so everything for production of automated miners is being handled over here. After that we have the level 2, and over here obviously we have our gas filter and iron filter production. We have all the buffers, all the logic, and after that we have our cterium being converted into the quick wire. Very straightforward, nothing else is going on, just a bunch of logic over here with all our smart splitters. Over here on the level number 3, it is sort of an interesting thing. Over here we have our blenders on top of the blueprint because, well, it's way easier to work with them from beneath because, well, they are kind of big and you couldn't really like stack them a lot, but this is the only way how you can stack them horizontally. They barely fit into 4x4, and by feeding both machines from the beneath you kind of can avoid all the issues with, well, extra space. So here we have the hookups for the water, for the nitrogen gas, and then we have a lot of like logic on several levels. We have a bunch of logic over here on multi-levels for the rubber, actual heatsinks, so over here we have 4 assemblers for the heatsink. And of course we have the logic to split them up into our personal storage container or into the actual cooling system production. And after that we have the final level, level number 4, and over here I have 2 manufacturers for the portable miners at 100% because, well, I love not to use extra power, you know. And over here we have 1 manufacturer at 150% producing turbo motors. Very straightforward, nothing special over here, only 3 manufacturers, bunch of logic, and just 2 buffers for, well, our radio control units and for our motors. The connections for the imports are very straightforward. They are always on the one side of the blueprint. It is usually on the left side if you are facing the face of the blueprint, and they are sort of like under the skirt. Yeah, my English is very nice, so I'm talking naughty things. So, the nitrogen over here, then we have coal, after that we have our cerium and rubber, then we have our iron, aluminum ingot intake, and obviously we have our water over here. For the water I have the pumps, for the nitrogen I have no pumps. So there's that. And if you never exported blueprints, you will need to do this manually. You need to go to your system disk, users, your username, app data, local, factory game, saved, save games, blueprints. There your game session would create a folder once you have blueprints unlocked in your progression and have created first blueprint. Every blueprint consists from 2 parts, .sbp file with parts and items, and .sbp cfg file with stack description and color settings. And well, there's the end of the video, so thank you very much for watching, have a nice one, and until next time, yakis out!